thank you all for coming out today. We have a very good audience here because everybody's excited for JD being here today. And I first want to thank the Reese Museum for having us here. This is, as we mention every time, this is one of the Tennessee Music Pathways, one of the destinations on that trail for the state of Tennessee. And so thank you to Randy Sanders and Spencer and all of the staff here. They deserve a big hand. Thank them for allowing us to do this. And I also want to thank Mr. Jerry Keys down here on the end. Jerry.
Yeah.
Jerry's very well known to this area. He's one of the patriarchs of the banjo here in East Tennessee. And I've known him for 15, 18, 19 years, something like that. And it's always fun to see him. But since he's been teaching, he came up and said, he said, what would you think about getting J.D. Crowe to come to campus? If he'd do it, if we could get him here. And I said, boy, we'll move heaven and earth. And we'll even go get him a cup of coffee if he'll do it. So, but thank you, Jerry, for setting this up and helping this to happen.
Yeah, I don't blame him.
I wanted to start, you know, if we had a theme for today, the thing that always strikes me about JD's music over the years, and we were talking about this just a minute ago, one of my favorite artists is George Jones. And his sound over the years, you know, George's singing was always country. But through the years, the music around him changed. In the early days, there, you know, was very kind of 50s country, and then it got some rockabilly to it. Then it got to be the Nashville sound, later the Countrypolitan sound by Billy Sherrill's arrangements. But the thing that remained the same was George. He always was country. And JD's music, for me, has always been that way. You always know JD is in the mix. You hear his banjo tone. You hear the signature sound of what he always does, from the years with Jimmy Martin to the Kentucky Mountain Boys, and then with New South, and then later kind of going back into traditional bluegrass. So I want to talk a lot about that because there are a lot of musicians here today. Yeah. All these young people you see here, they're all students at the university, and they're good musicians too, and they want to know how to make their music viable, how to survive, how to reach people. And one of the best examples, I think, that there are many examples. I was trying to think of what we could use to demonstrate. But if CJ would cue up, here is a version of one of JD's recordings. And then just a few years later, a second recording. So why don't you go ahead and cue up that first one. This is the earlier cut.
This old town's filled with sin. It'll swallow you in if you've got some money to burn. Take it home right away. You've got 3 years to pay. But Satan is waiting his turn.
And then just a few years later, he's got a guy named Keith Whitley. Some of you might have heard of him. He's got this sound going on.
This old town's filled with sin. It'll swallow you in if you've got some money to burn. Take it home right away. You've got 3 years to pay. But Satan is waiting his turn.
Folks, everybody, we're so proud today to have at East Tennessee State University Mr. J.D. Crowe.
It seems like this whole time.
Okay.
take me back. Your story seems to me to be like a lot of people who play bluegrass music. You, when you were young, you heard Ernest Tubb and Billy Bird playing the electric guitar.
Right.
Was music always in your house growing up? Was your family listening to music?
My mom and dad, they always liked it, although neither one of them ever played. But they liked the music. And we'd always listen to the Grand Ole Opry. And I guess ever since I remember 4, 5, 6 years old, I always had a little ukulele or something banging around all trying to play it. And I always wanted, the thing that stuck out of my mind of a style or an instrument being different was Ernest Tubb. Because you could hear the three notes of that guitar, you knew who it was. And that always stuck in my mind. That's what I wanted to do, was play a guitar like that. And until I saw Flatt Scruggs, well, that all changed.
And that was about 1950.
Right.
Where did you see them at? What was that experience like?
Back in Lexington, Kentucky, where I'm from, they had a Kentucky Mountain Barn Dance, they called it, every Saturday night. And it was your local pro musician, and they would bring an Opry act in every week. It was my best Saturday night. And that's where I kind of started going to that. And one night we were there, and unbeknownst to us, because they weren't advertised, Flatt Scruggs was on the show. Well, I'd never seen him or heard of him. But when they hit that stage, that was the fastest 15 minutes I believe I've ever spent. It was like 5 minutes and it was gone. But that was an eye-opener for me. Man, I never forgot that. And I wanted to do that.
Who would have been in the band that night, do you remember?
Was Flatt Scruggs, Curly Sackler, Benny Sims, and this was before Josh joined, and Cedric Rainwater playing bass. That was in that group at that time.
Pretty stout group.
Yes, it was.
And Benny Sims, he used to live here in East Tennessee. Jerry would remember.
Yeah. Can I say something?
Sure.
Yes.
I took JD up to see Benny when Benny was sick, you know, before he passed away. Anyway, Benny said, yeah, I remember J.D. Crowe said he was that little red-headed boy that followed Scruggs around.
So that's it.
Yep.
The little red-headed boy that followed Scruggs around.
Yeah, I used to go, they had a radio show at there right out in Lexington, a place called Sales, and the radio station in the library. And they had a show that 15 minutes, come on, 11:45. Every Saturday morning. Well, my dad would take me, because he had met Lester and Earl before, and Dad never met a stranger. So he and Lester were big buddies. They talked. And Earl never said a lot, you know, he's kind of laid back. But we'd go down to this radio station, and their show was 11:45. They would come in about 10 and rehearse. So here I'm sitting as close to those people to me, and I'm watching all this. This is live. Do they rehearse? Then when it comes behind, they do the radio show.
All right, so what was it like? What were their rehearsals like?
They just do the run over the songs that they were going to do that day on the show.
Did they ever stop and say, oh, we messed up? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Nobody's perfect. You know, yeah. Even them. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, they were just playing. They'd only run through a verse or chorus or something, and they'd go into something else.
You didn't get to see them work out their harmonies, or did they?
No.
They didn't do stuff like that.
No, they were already had that down.
They knew that, okay.
Yeah. They were just running over the material they were going to do, you know, show.
So you were probably in your early teens then,
oh,
right?
Oh, yes.
So.
Yeah. Wow. Probably 14.
Did Earl encourage you?
Well, he inspired me. I mean, Earl, he didn't say much. I know my dad one time asked him, said, Earl, it would, it'd be possible if you'd show. Dad called me Jack. That's all he ever called me. If he said J.D., I knew I was in trouble. But he said, hey, isn't that way you show Jack something? Earl says, he's welcome to learn everything he can, but I don't know what I'm doing. That's the thing he said. And I did it. That didn't make sense to me. But later I realized what he was saying. He didn't. He was just doing it, doing what he heard at the time.
It was very easy for Earl Scruggs to be Earl Scruggs, wasn't it?
Yes.
So you were probably playing a cheap banjo back then, just whatever
well,
you could
everybody
find.
Everybody starts with a K. $39.95. Back in the '50s, hey, that wasn't bad, you know. But I wanted a banjo like Earl had. That was my goal.
Did you eventually get one before you started playing?
Yeah, 40 years later.
Is that what you have right here? Why don't you tell us what you're holding?
Well, it's just a banjo.
It's not just a banjo, I guarantee.
No, Jerry knows all about this deal. This is a banjo, but I tried to buy in the late 70s, early 80s. The man would never sell it. He would not even talk about it at the time. And I just forgot about it. But I knew where it was. But I thought, well, he'll sell it best and somebody else will get it. You know, and anyway, this banjo is, there was five of these made in the sequence. So 95-84-1. There was only five made in that sequence. Sonny's is two, Earl's is three. The fourth one is a top tension. Now, don't ask me why Gibson did it that way, I don't know. But the fifth one is the fellow in North Carolina.
Tim Mike.
This guy. Mm-hmm. And I played all of those, except number four. I never saw that. Mm-hmm. But this is the number one.
Wow. What's it sound like?
Like a banjo. Play it.
Yeah.
I got it about 20 years too late, really. I wish I'd had this back when I was playing, you know. But I had a chance to get it, and I wasn't going to turn it down, you know.
Yeah, I know you're really known for the banger.
For
that banjo, and I know you sold it. You sold it just a few years ago.
Yeah.
How does this one compare tonally to that one?
Totally different.
Totally different, really?
Yeah, it's different.
How would you describe the differences? Was the banger more punchy or?
They're all punchy. That's in the right hand. That's where you get that.
Show us that again. You're known for that.
Yeah, I don't play much anymore, to be honest with you.
Uh-huh.
That's why it's kind of, I got burnt out. 60 years of doing it is a long time. And, you know, why should I do it? I've already done it. So, you know, I just wanted this because it's something I've tried to get for years. You know, and I finally had the chance to get it. But like I said, I'm retired. I don't even really need one.
Well, for the banjo nerds out there, this is a, would it be a 1930s? I don't want to get
this
the year
is 34.
Wrong.
34.
Yeah. Granada, Gibson Granada, original flathead.
Yep.
Did it have the original five-string neck on it when you got it? So you still have the original neck?
Oh, yes.
This must be a Frank Neat neck.
Exactly.
It looks like a Frank Neat neck. Frank lives in Kentucky, and he's about, by all the banjo player accounts, Frank makes the best replica of a pre-war style neck.
Does. Yes, as far as I'm concerned, it does. Mm-hmm. I'm sure a lot of fellows will say that too.
Yeah. So you keep the neck at home and tucked away?
Yes, it's put up.
Because a lot of times those will break.
There's
no shortage of old.
Once you break an original neck, you've killed the banjo, that banjo a lot.
Yeah.
Because that's worth a lot.
Mm-hmm. What is the value?
The what?
What is the value?
I don't want to say.
Okay.
It's whatever you can get out of it.
Somebody escort this man out of here, please. Get it. Yeah. He needs to be gone.
Yeah. It's how bad a man wants this if you're selling it.
The market on them fluctuates a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
But
no.
Yeah, they're probably not. I think the peak of those instrument markets were probably 2008, 2007, 2008. They were kind of at the peak. But, of course, the five-string Gibsons, they're very,
now this
not very many of them.
This particular banjo, and it's been an original, it's way up there. Mm-hmm. I know a man tried to buy it, and he liked $5,000 for coming up with it. And this was way up there, and they would not sell it.
Even for five?
No.
Well, I think it's in good hands. I think for somebody who's helped form our music over the last 60 years deserves to have an instrument like that.
Well, like I said, I haven't played it enough to get used to it, to be honest. And because every banjo plays different. You know, I had one. In fact, there was 2 digits difference in serial numbers between mine and Jerry's. 75.
It was 752-2.
Mine was 4.
Dash 4.
You know.
And Glenn Rose is here. Glenn,
yes.
What serial number is yours?
Yes, he's got one.
Dash 1.
Dash 1, yeah.
So y'all are about close in there together?
Yeah, that's right.
Jerry, what year is yours?
It was shipped June 1st, 1938.
38,
yeah. To a pawn shop and pawn shop / music store in, I believe it's Danville, Virginia.
Now, you still keep the original neck on yours, don't you?
No.
Oh, that's not.
Mine's put up.
Okay, all right. For some reason. But that must be an older neck, huh?
Well, this is a Frank neck, and he normally builds his necks the way he builds them. But I asked him if he would try to replicate the finish on my old neck, and he did. And he don't do that a lot, but he did do that for me.
Okay. So he's got the varnish, the old varnish.
Off and stuff.
Could we twist your arm and get you to pick a little something, or do you?
It'd be very little.
Well, as much or as little as you want to.
I've got all these pickers in here, man, you know. I know there's some good pickers in here.
Well, there are some good pickers.
Yeah.
But they've been listening to you their whole lives, that's why.
That I know, obviously, I don't know. But the ones I do know here, and they could be pro. They could win pro at any time. And some of them, I think a couple of them were. One time, you know, they're good. They're great friends of mine, you know. Really enjoy being around and listening to them pick. You know? But I don't play a lot anymore, as I suppose you. And I'll tell you one thing, if you don't do it, you lose it. Very easy. Because this system is not something you play a few years and put it down for 4 or 5 years, it don't come back. You know, oh, you remember it up here, but transferring it down here, that's another thing. And my thing is, I always like to play under pressure. If you're on a stage and you're doing a concert, you're under pressure. You got to come with it. That's it. And therefore, you have to practice, stay with it if you're going to be pro. But just to sit around the house and play, I never do that anymore at all. I think this, before I came down to Jerry's, it's probably the first time I'd had this badge out in 2 months out of the case. I mean, you know, I love it and I miss it, but I don't have the incentive to do it like I used to.
Traveling on the road's pretty hard, isn't it?
Gilbert, yes.
Yeah.
Why I look like this.
Let me ask you then about the early days. You were very young when you started working with Jimmy Martin, and I know that you worked with another band or two to get there. But how old were you when you started with Jimmy?
You know, the first time I started with Jimmy, Jimmy had been working with Bill Monroe, lead singer, for years. He left Bill. I was playing with a country band, actually. And the country band, they were pro. And they had a radio show at 6 Saturday night, live studio audience. He was on 6 to 7 and had a bunch of sponsors, that type of thing. And he put out a talent show. I used to do this years ago. And the prize was, if you won the talent show, you got to be on his radio show. So I won one. You know, so anyway, I didn't have to follow the monkey. You don't ever follow
a little kid or something.
You've lost.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Or a bass player who just did a solo. Yeah.
But anyway, that was my prize. I got to be on his show. And I done two numbers. And then I kind of played in the background with them. You know, because there's a country, electric guitar, steel, a whole bit, you know, fed up. But anyway, Jimmy Martin was on his way to Middletown, Ohio. So he had to come through Lexington. He happened to hear that radio program and heard me play. He called the radio station. You know, and what a freaky thing that was. Of course, I didn't know Jimmy from Adam back then. And he had called and asked if my parents were there and he wanted to speak to them, you know. So they came and got my dad. He spoke with him, and he told his dad who he was, you know, and all that. So he came to the radio station and talked to me and my family. And I was out of school at the time, and I went to Middletown, Ohio. I think this was 54.
Had no idea you were going to do that.
No. So he was a good talker, you know, he could talk to you in anything. But anyway, I did. I went up there and spent a couple months playing with him. And that was one time I went with him. Second time I went with Jimmy, it was 1956. I started with him, and I stayed 5 years. And then that's actually where I really started learning.
So you'd been about 19 then, right, or so?
Right, I was 19 years old, right.
And that band would have included Paul Williams.
Not at the time.
No.
Earl Taylor.
Ah, okay.
Taylor playing mandolin. The banjo player before me was Sam Hutchins. Called him Porky. He was from Maryland. Good banjo player. And he decided to quit and go back to Maryland. So and that's when Jimmy called me then again. And I don't know if I'd be interested. So, of course, I did, and let's say the rest is history.
How long was it until you all started on the Louisiana Hayride?
58.
Right. Okay. The Louisiana Hayride, those of you who were here for Paul Williams' seminar last semester, it rivaled the Grand Ole Opry. There were a few stations and shows around the country that were kind of competitors with the Opry. The Ozark Jubilee would have been one. WWVA up in Wheeling was another. But all of these big stations, they were where you wanted to be.
Oh, yeah.
They had the 50,000-watt towers, and they could get you listened to from all over the United States.
All over the U.S.
So you had to be pretty good. Did you run into Elvis while you were on the Louisiana Hayride?
He'd already been there and gone.
Already?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he would have been there in 56, right?
I know a lot of him, though.
What's that?
I knew a lot of people that knew him.
Really?
Yeah. Told a lot of good tales on him.
You got any Elvis tales for us today?
I'll just let that ride.
All right. Paul and you and Jimmy had great trio.
Let me correct you one thing.
All right.
I said Earl Taylor was with Jimmy when I started. Then Earl left and Paul came in 57. Mm-hmm. And that's when I first met Paul. I knew of Paul because I'd heard about some fine fiddlers. And that's who Paul was with before he went into his Air Force. Paul joined the Air Force and he had just gotten out when he joined Jimmy. Jimmy knew him from the old Lonesome Pine Fenders. And Jimmy and Bob Osborne used to work together years ago. And they were all, Bob worked with the Lonesome Pine Fenders for a while. You know, and that's before Sonny learned to play the banjo. He was just learning, of course. And Sonny and I talked about that. Well, I remember the first time I met Bob and Sonny, it was 1954 at this radio station that we were playing in. They came down and did a guest job.
Well,
I've known them since 1954.
Wow. That's... I don't even know what 1954 was like. That predates me.
No, you wouldn't. Most of them in here wouldn't.
That predates most of us. Where did you learn to sing the baritone part?
Jimmy. Jimmy knew all the parts. He could sing lead, tenor, baritone, a little bass even. You know, he had a unique voice. And he knew parts. And he showed me, and I just took it up from there.
And, well, you're known as being, you know, we had Eddie Adcock here a few weeks ago. Eddie's another one of these banjo players. It seems like for a long time, all the tenor singers wanted to play mandolin, so they look like Bill. The guitar players wanted to sing lead, and all the banjo players want to sing baritone, yeah. Like you and Eddie and the banjo players.
It's worked out that way.
Yeah.
It's just more convenient, I guess.
Well, you do some particular little scoops and slides.
Yeah. You change.
Yeah, it's a style that you've come up with on that.
When myself and Doyle Lawson, Larry Rice, Bobby Sloan were together, I sung most of the lead in the trios. Doyle did the tenor, and Larry did the baritone. A lot of people think that Larry is the lead singer, and I did the baritone. Well, we did on some songs, we'd switch. But we worked it out to where it was the way we felt it was the best, the strongest. And I sung a lot of lead in the trios. I never did any solo work except for a line or two or something, but I never got in. I never did want to do solo.
Why not?
I didn't feel it, really. You know, and I learned at a very early age. There's singers and there's singers.
And you've worked with some singers.
Yes. Yeah, I leave that to them.
Yeah.
I'll just do the harmony. So.
There, especially at that time, and there haven't been a lot of band leaders who weren't the front man and the lead singer.
That's true. Most of them were your lead singers, actually. You know, but I guess there's pros and cons about that, you know. But it just, most people think if you're a band leader, you're the lead singer, mm-hmm. play guitar. That's not true in a lot of cases.
Do you have any notable experiences, good musical things that happened while you were with Jimmy in those years in the 50s?
Oh, there were some dances. Yeah.
Yeah. Good ones?
Some of them you can only put in a book.
But we'll buy it if you write it.
No, I had a great time with Jimmy. He was Jimmy. He was, you had to know him. A lot of people didn't like him. You know, and I could see why. He had a weird sense of humor. So, I mean, he was one of a kind. He would tell you real quick, if you don't want to hear it, don't ask him. Probably it put you down. That's just the way he was. He told the truth. You know, I remember somebody asking one time they was talking, and they said, you know, you can't make a living playing bluegrass music. He looked up and said, well, do you think you really play bluegrass?
Can you really play? Can you actually play?
Yeah, do you think you can play bluegrass? That's just the way he was. You know, he was right.
He, did it take a certain toughness in those days to try to get your name out, get your music out, to work hard at it, to play it well?
Yeah. It did a lot.
Jimmy had a lot of that drive.
Oh, yes. Most of anybody I've ever seen, really. He had that.
So when did you leave Jimmy? And where did you go after
61.
That? 61. Yeah. What did you do after that?
I went back to my hometown, Lexington, Kentucky, and got a 7-to-5 job, which we all love, and But I played like 2 to 3 nights a week, every week, in clubs. So, you know, I was making pretty decent money, even back then. Because what you made in clubs is cash. You know, you didn't pay tax on it.
Right in your pocket.
So that's it. And we did that. We just played what we wanted to. You know, that's the way we had the album we had on. We played what we wanted to play. And it worked.
How did the transition, a lot of people here probably know your history in those years of meeting Bobby Sloan and then Doyle and eventually Tony, and things kind of grew
right,
kind of organically for you, didn't they?
It did. It, a lot of it's luck, too. But of course, I knew a lot of papers back then. I met a lot of them, and you kind of keep in the loop of who's who, and you listen to the young artists, people's coming up. You know who the singers are, pickers. And we were playing this club, and it wasn't a very big place, but just a place. We had a lot of college students come in at this time. And I remember a lot of times there was a UK students in Eastern Kentucky, which was Richmond, Kentucky. They would pile in on Friday and Saturday nights, you know, and we just played what we wanted to. Of course, we didn't play the stuff. We knew it, we'd do it, you know. And we were playing different stuff. We'd play a little country and whatever was popular. People wanted to hear, we'd try to do it, you know.
So you'd be in a club and people would say, hey, this song by the Birds or this song by somebody, could y'all learn it, Bluegrass?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That's how that started?
Over. How that all came about, Dad, is when the Holiday Inn deal, we were playing there, and people got around. You know, we were packing out this club every weekend. You couldn't get him in, you know. And we had some people come in, and I didn't know who they were, that were actually from the Holiday Inn unit. The people that worked for the Holiday Inns.
Big corporate somebody?
They worked for the Holiday Inn establishment.
Okay.
In some form. There was a guy, there was a gal there that was in, she was going to the UK. Her father built the first Holiday Inn that was in Lexington.
Hmm.
In fact, he built 3 of them there. And he later became the biggest stockholder in the Holiday Inn scene, you know, so. Anyway, they kept telling him that they need to get us up to the Holiday Inn. So we was packing his place out. They couldn't believe it, because they couldn't get in a lot of times when they'd come in, you know, come down. So he came down, the owner, and went like, of course, these things go in one ear and out the other. You hear all this bull, I call it the lot.
Mm.
And he approached me and introduced himself. Approached me about, said, now, would you like to come work Polly in? I'm thinking, oh yeah, okay. Because the only music that was ever in the Holiday Inn that I could remember was, I call them Johnny Lounge pickers. You know, some lady playing piano and a guy playing jazz guitar. That's about the extent of it, you know. And I said, I don't know about that deal, because this is a nice place. And, the Red Slipper Lounge, that's what I was thinking of. So, I agreed. He said, well, let's do a 3-night thing, starting out Thursday, Friday, Saturday. It's okay. So, meanwhile, Dawn was with me then. He just joined the group. And We both had day jobs working at the club, you know. And I said, okay. So we started it Thursday night. Now, remember, the Holiday Inn is a big organization. Well, they did TV advertisements. They did, it was in the paper. In every room, there was a brochure.
Hmm.
On every table at the lounge, there was our picture. So we were going to start there on that particular Thursday night. Well, I mean, everybody in the city knew it. Okay, Thursday night came, you could not get in that place. Well, let's open the eyes of that owner that I'll be in. He said, okay. Well, we did that 3 nights. We did it 2 weeks. He came to me and said, would you like to sign a year's contract for 5 nights a week? You know, I thought long
five
and hard
a week,
about
man.
That, yeah. Because, as I looked at Doyle, we were talking about it, says, I could not do a 7-to-5 job and work 5 nights a week in a club.
You'd have to quit your day
okay,
job.
I'd have to do one or the other. Well, I tried it a month. Oh, that was it. So I looked at Doyle, and we're either going to have to do this or give it up. You know, we neither one can do this. And he said, well, we can always get a job doing it. I said, well, that's true. Back then you could. And I said, okay, let's go for it. Well, we did. We stayed there. That was in 68. The fall of 68 started. And we stayed there until January of 1975.
Wow. That is.
Because I only signed a contract. I was 4 months I took off. Played festivals and other venues. You know. But we worked 8 months out of the year at that Holiday Inn. 5 nights a week, 4 sets a night.
You might have been the highest paid banjo player in the world at that time.
At that time
except maybe Earl Scruggs.
That's true.
Wow. Right around those years, you started recording, too.
Yeah,
I know there was the Lemco
right.
label.
Yeah.
Where you, matter of fact, one of our students here, he brought me a 45 about a year ago, and we transferred 45. It over. There was a 45 record of Come On Down to My World. And
yep. I remember us doing that.
And Fields That Are Green, yeah. These days, people get kind of religious about what type of bluegrass they like. You know, some people, they want straight up hard drive and traditional bluegrass.
Yeah.
Some people like the complete opposite. They want to hear Bela Fleck and...
Yeah.
What was the audience like then? Did they care what you did? Like, did people come up and say, you've lost your way, JD. You're playing all this country stuff.
Not really.
No.
No. As you mentioned, Bela was back there, they wasn't even started yet.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
Pretty much. But anyway, no, that's kind of way thing to why I changed. Because when you're doing a club, you're catering to all kinds of people. Your regular fans, and you're trying to get new fans over to the music. That's why we changed in these things that we did. Because you got to know a lot of songs and do a lot of requests that people hear on the radio. And you have to do that to survive. If you don't, you're not going to stay there too long. If you don't make that cash register ring, that club, you ain't going to be there very long. That's the bottom line right there. And we did.
So you made the decision, we're going to learn as much as we can, cater to people.
That's right. That's it. And although it got very tiring, and you just wanted to quit so many times, so, you know, but I didn't.
Well, any job would be that way, right?
That's exactly. I mean, it is a job.
Every job has days where
that's right.
Where it's
And I'll tell you what it made me, and people that was in the band will attest to this also. Made him a lot better picker. It's called more versatile. You're learning a lot. You stay loose. You don't have time to think of anything else. You know, when you're doing 5 nights a week, 4 sets a night.
You're getting a lot of good practice.
Yes.
4 sets a night, 45-minute sets? 40-minute sets.
Well, it got started that way, but later on, it got to be 30-minute sets.
Mm-hmm. You made that decision.
You know, hey, we was bringing them in, so, you know, they start hollering, hey, place, it's time to go back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so.
You've got to work with a lot of
great
musicians over the years. And in those days, you mentioned Doyle Lawson was part of your band. And Tony Rice came along, of course, Larry Rice.
Larry. Tony King, Glenn Lawson, just all kinds of good pickers. Jimmy Goodrow.
Keith Whitley.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that's. Of course, that time we'd already moved out of the club scene.
So how did you transition away from that, out of the clubs and into?
It was very easy, really. We just wouldn't go. I wouldn't go back after I did all that. I wouldn't go back unless it's a one night stand. Something, but no permanent clubs anymore. I wouldn't do that. I paid my dues doing that. Mm-hmm. We all did.
I see. When did things start taking off to the point where you could leave that and start touring more?
Well, there again, I just got through talking to Albert Hyde about this. Carlton Haney was a big factor in that. He was starting his festivals. And then he had heard about us. We was getting popular and stuff, and he called, wanted to book us on his festivals. And he was running 4 or 5 a year. So we were on like every one of them. And so that's kind of how all that evolved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Albert, are you here, Albert, still? Oh, there you are. Albert Hyde is back there. He was one of the film producers for Bluegrass Country Soul, which was that 1971 Camp Springs festival that all of us know so well, thanks to Albert and his team. And of course, JD is on that movie playing Train 45, and you've got Larry and Tony with you that day.
It's
a pretty powerful group.
Yeah.
Miss Colleen Trenwith, she's standing back there. Colleen, you were touring the States in 1971 as well, weren't you? Did you see JD in those days? Did you run into him?
Yes.
Did you? Colleen with the Hamilton County Bluegrass Band from New Zealand.
Oh, okay.
So I bet you all ran together.
Yeah, I met a lot of pickers, a lot of different people back then.
Yeah. The Japanese groups were coming in and playing bluegrass.
Yeah.
It seems like that must have been a good time frame in the 1970s for bluegrass to get new audiences, thanks to Carlton.
He was a big deal in doing that.
When did you add drums and start the country sound? At the Holiday Inn.
Because that was a good place to do it. Hmm.
See. You could try stuff out.
Oh, yeah. And people, I know we converted a lot of people that didn't really like or care for hardcore bluegrass. When we did that, and we were basically playing the same thing. We were just louder. Really. You know, I had a pickup on the banjo, but I had an amp, but I was actually still playing the mic. You know, but a drummer has to hear, be able to hear you, keep time. And of course, we use electric bass, which makes it louder. Percussion, so that's why we did that, because we did things that was a little different. We did Jim Croce tunes, some of the old country rock stuff, and we even did a Beatles tune a couple times, just trying things out, and it's just a lot of fun to experiment with that.
What are your favorite types of music? What did you listen to driving down here?
Well, we listened to Flatt Scruggs.
I can't blame you.
Yeah. That's, to me, the alpha and omega of bluegrass. It started there and it ended there. Because it'll never be done any better. I don't care how good you are. Now, that particular type of music will never be done any better than what they did.
You don't hear that sound at any festival.
Close.
Yeah. The closest thing might be the Earls of Leicester, who are doing a tribute to that.
Well,
But it was the original. And you don't hear that sound emulated as much.
No.
I mean, everybody likes to learn some Scruggs licks, but they don't sound like Scruggs.
They don't.
Did you, when you were learning Scruggs style and developing your style, were you trying to play note for note like Earl, or were you just getting the feeling of it?
Probably that happened before I went with Jimmy, Jimmy Martin. That happened before then. You know, if it wasn't Scruggs, I didn't want to play it. You know, but when I went with Jimmy, it was different. His rhythm was different. You couldn't play like Earl and play his type of music, really. And I started listening to that and hearing other things. I listen, you ask me, listen to all kinds of music. I listen to rock and roll, rhythm and blues, some jazz, even big band sounds. You know, I listen to all that. And man, you can incorporate licks, different bands and musicians, guitar, pianos, saxophone licks. You can do that. You can incorporate any words to get it just right. You know?
Well, you've done a great job at becoming a stylist on the banjo.
Well, you have to be a little different. Of course, my favorite is Scruggs. You know, that's it. But there'll never be another one.
That's it. I'd like to open it up to questions in a second, so be thinking about what you want to ask. But before I do that, I didn't know until recently, well, maybe 10 years ago, when I learned that you were the one who produced Keith Whitley's country record, the first one, right?
Yeah.
Would you tell us a little bit about that? Because I thought of you as a band leader, but and as a banjo player, a baritone singer, but you must really have a good knack for producing, too, huh?
Well, I know what I like, but I try to think what other people would like. You know, I don't want to put it on myself. But I knew what Keith wanted, and I knew what I could do. And when I did that somewhere between an album then, still albums, I talked to him about it. I said, you really want to do a country album, you know? And of course he said, yeah. He says, man, I can't believe you're going to do that. And I said, hey, you want to do that? We'll do this album. It'll be J.D. Crowe in the South, but you'll be the featured vocalist, you know? Mm-hmm. And I knew he wanted to do country, and I knew he could do it. And I got some material together. He brought in a few things he liked. And I got quite a bit of stuff I liked. I pitched it to him, he liked it. I said, we need to try to do something different that nobody's heard. And then throw in a few that people have heard. Show your talent, you know. And in fact, I only played banjo with two cuts on that album. I played rhythm guitar on the other part, you know, on it and produced it. And I always wanted to use, I kind of did it, it was like the 60s style of country, if you remember that. Mm-hmm. That's when kind of Jones was changing a little bit.
Oh yeah.
A little bit more modern sound, you know. And I always really liked that particular style. And I loved the Jordanaires. They're the best backup vocal group that ever was.
Yeah.
You know, there's no mistaking when you hear them, you know who it is. And I got to use them. I called them. And I said, yeah, man, we'd love to do that. And I got to use them on that recording, that album, with Keith.
There are some band leaders who would not be that generous.
This is very true.
I mean, some band leaders, it's all about that star.
Oh, yeah.
It has to be. And they don't want to help their band. Sometimes they want to keep them down. They get jealous.
That's true. I know a few of them like that.
Yeah, they get jealous.
I can't say, but that's the way it is.
But don't you feel like you miss out if you keep holding people back? You miss out on something really good that could happen.
That's true.
And you're smart enough to see that somebody who's able to do something really well.
I saw very early, in fact, with the 75 band, I call it, to Ricky, Tony, and Jerry, myself, and Bobby. When they left, I knew very real quick, you could not replace that sound. You can't take a guy and make him sell it for somebody else. That don't work. You're defeating your purpose. You gotta make a change. When they leave, you hire people that can do the job, but they're gonna sound different. And you work with that within their, in that realm of the music. You work to their best. You take, say, a lead singer, you get the best out of him you can. Let him be himself. Let him sing like himself. And that's what I told Keith. I said, there's already been a George Jones, and a Lefty Frizzell, and a Merle Haggard. I said, you need to sound like Keith. It's good, just like I like Scruggs. But I said, he's already done it. You can't beat a man at his own game. That don't work, you know. So you have to do something a little different. You can take what you learn from him and incorporate it. Everybody's got people they like and follow. And you can use some of the things he did, but not all of it, you know. And but that's okay. I said, Keith, you need to sound like Keith. You can throw in a few inflections of Lefty and Merle and Jordan, but don't try to sound like them. Let yourself come out. And he did.
Was it, you know, in music, band members come and go.
Yeah.
For a band to be together for 5 or 6 years, 7 years, that's a long time to be together. Were there times where, did you ever get your feelings hurt, or did you ever get discouraged when band members needed to move on?
Not really. Well, yeah, you get depressed. I mean, that's the place you hate to lose a good member and a friend, you know, also. But things happen, and they've got to happen. Stay too long, you get stale. It's hard to make a change, but most of the time it works out. You start developing something a little different. A little different sounds, with the different than your people. Whether it be a mallet player, tenor singer, lead singer, whatever. It changes, so you change with it. You incorporate that together.
And then your audience has a brand new thing to listen to.
That's right.
J.D. Crowe sounds entirely different with
this
new band around him.
That's it.
Well, why don't we ask some questions? Let's some people ask some questions.
I'll ask them best I can.
Watch nobody raise their hand now. Okay, all right. You're not allowed to ask about money.
No.
All right.
The most significant album.
I know
album,
what you're going to ask on that.
The most significant album in bluegrass was the 75 album.
Yeah. Yeah.
It changed music. It changed bluegrass. It changed all of us. Tell us a little bit about how that band came together. And you didn't, 1 year was all you did, but tell us how that band came together.
Best I can remember. I'm trying to think who did and all that happened. Ricky Skaggs had left the country gentleman. He was working in a factory or something, someplace. And I had a good friend of mine that was acting as a manager, or, you know, helped us out doing a few things. And he knew that Ricky was available. He said, why don't you call Skaggs? See if he'll come down and, you know, play, at least for a while, you know. And I thought about it, I said, yeah, I know he could probably cut it, you know. And, of course, Tony was still with me. That's when Larry had left. And so I did. I called him. And he said, yeah, he said, man, I'd love to. And get back in thinking. But I know after he came down, he told me, Ricky did, said, Crowe, he said, I'll be honest with you. I want to get my own band someday. I want to have my own group. I said, hey, that's fine. Come down and work with us till you get ready. Just let me know where you're going to leave. You know? So he did, and that was the way we left it. And when it come time, they left. He left, you know. And of course, Tony left to say, Tony had been with me almost 5 years. Well, he was getting tired. He wanted to change. I could see that. I really hated to lose those two.
Yeah.
You just don't replace that. That's why I said a while ago, you don't try to make somebody sound like Tony and Ricky, because that's not going to happen. You know, so you go on, you get something different. But anyway, and that's how Ricky came in the band. Because I'd seen Ricky perform, him and Keith with Ralph, you know. And my thought was, I don't want somebody that sounds like Ralph. It won't fit in this band, you know, and it wouldn't. But I knew he could do it. You know, he could do like Ralph, or he could do it like himself. He was a natural tenor singer. He had a good lead singer also, and a good mellow player, a good fiddle player. He had it. A lot of talent, you know. So we worked great together. And when we did that album, we'd been doing that stuff in the Holiday Inn and for years. So we decided how that album came about. I was approached by the other one, Rounder. They were just getting started at the time. They wanted me to do a banjo instrumental album. And I never was real hot on doing a lot of instrumentals. You know, you do a few, you have as being a, you know, instrumentals you expect to play instrumentals. And I always wanted band sound, singing, you know, kickoffs, backup. To me, that's what I like. I can hear two instrumentals and I'm tired of them, you know. And you do them on stage because people expect you to do it, you know, so you do that, you know. But anyway, they wanted me to do an instrumental album. I said, no, I will not do an instrumental album. I will do a band album, meaning we'll get songs, get us some songs, and we'll go in and record them. And they consented to do that because they saw that I was not going to do an instrumental album, you know. And they'd be still trying to get me to do one. I said, no, I'm not interested, you know. But anyway, that's how that album came about. So we recorded at the Silver Springs, Maryland, 75.
And I saw where they have a re-release of the vinyl now they're selling. So if you
they
want...
Are, yeah. I don't know why they're doing that. But.
Well, J.D., did you hear that this year vinyl sales may outsell CD sales for the first time since 1986 or something? Yeah.
They say thanks, make a circle.
Yeah. Isn't that funny? You know, speaking of that record too, and Keith and some of the others that have worked with you, you can get those Red Slipper Lounge recordings and things like that.
They
might have been, yeah, they might have been
bootlegged. They're all over the internet.
But you can hear people's style change.
Sure.
You can hear Keith's sound change when he worked with you.
Oh, yeah.
From what he was doing with Ralph. And then by the time he was done with you, he started to sound like what eventually he would
be wanting to do. Yeah. Well, I know what I talked to Keith about it, and I knew he had problems. But I was willing to overlook that for the time being. Anyway, I talked to Keith about it. He told me, you know, you're the only person I would go to work with. He said, because I don't want to do any more bluegrass, hardcore. He said, I like the New South because they're versatile. You do different stuff. It's not the same thing over and over.
You know? I see.
And that's what he told me. And that hit, you know, I said, yeah, well, that's good. And with him, we can venture out a little further. You know, so you take that and work that to your advantage.
I see.
You know. But that's how that album came about. That was our first endeavor.
Yeah. Thank you for this album. I really think it's the best album ever.
You know, we knew the songs. I loved some of those songs on that particular album. We probably didn't do over two times. Maybe some of them one day. Because we've done them so much. It's just like sitting down at the Holiday Inn.
Yeah, it was, you know, second nature.
Yeah. Wow. And I think that's why it turned out like it did. But it was a little different than what a lot of people were doing.
There's a little funny story that maybe you ought to tell about the cover changed.
You know, back then we was all crazy. You know, all these rock groups were doing crazy stuff, and you know, and these, I got really tired of hearing how it ought to be. Yeah, I thought, you know, what happened on that cover? You can tell it's in the fall. It was cold. We took that picture. It was down on a creek, and the boy taking that was not a pro photographer. He was actually a TV station manager who liked to do photography. And he's a friend of ours. He offered to do that. Well, he got down there, we goofed around, and he didn't bring enough film, really, but he was running out. And I thought, well, we got to get this something for Rounder, you know. So it came down, his last picture he took, and we just goofing around. And I just stuck my finger in like the reflection of in Bobby Sloan's ear.
Yeah.
And anyway, let me tell you about this. There's people that had that album for a year and never noticed that. That's true. Never noticed that. And I told Ken and everybody, I said, boy, we can't use that picture. He said, yeah, man, let's do that. Okay, I don't care. Talk to Ken about it. Well, talk to Ken about it. And then Ken, he's kind of, well, I don't know. This is what's up. I said, yeah, I'd use it. I'll tell you what to do, Ken. I said, use that when the first 10,000 is sold, change the cover. That will make that one worth more money because it's the original. And we did that. And sure enough, that album was going from as high as $35 to $50 if you could find it.
I would sell mine for that.
I've probably got about 20 albums of those left. Still shrink wrapped.
Oh no.
Oh
no.
Do I have money?
I'll give you $40 for one.
Thank
you,
sir. Yeah. No, really, that's how that came about. So,
that's a good story.
You know.
Do we have another question? In the back.
I'd like to tell you to comment. And I really admire his professionalism. Not where you remember, J.D., but he played the Bijou Theater one January in Knoxville back in the 90s. And it was 18 degrees or so outside, and it didn't have any heat. And you got up there and played and just killed it, didn't back off. And I really admire you for the professionalism. So that not playing through really adverse.
Well,
I don't even know how your fingers work.
And I don't either. I tell you, man, I play when it's snowing outside.
Good grief.
Yeah. Man. I mean, it is. It, your hands get cold, man. It's hard, you know.
No.
It's all you can do. You know, it's hard enough to play when you're warm.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, for sure.
I've played in all kinds of situations.
And sometimes the big electrical thunderstorms come through and the festival promoters won't shut down the stage.
You got to.
You got to keep going and you've got a lot of metal on those things.
You got that right.
You could light up like a Christmas tree.
Yeah.
Another question over here.
Yeah. You said you wanted an instrument, a Gibson, like Earl's playing.
Yeah.
So could you tell us about your first acquisition of a real Gibson banjo, a big banjo? And also, could you tell us about, I've heard the story of you and Jimmy Martin. Did he find a banjo and point you towards a banjo at a flea market or something one time?
What was that first one you asked?
Your first Gibson.
I started out with a Cade and my dad bought me an RV-100. Then after that he bought me a new Master Tone. They just started coming back out making the Master Tones again. They hadn't started making the flatheads yet. They were all raised heads. Mm. So I got one of those. I had one of those. And I thought I was in high cotton then, you know. And so got that. Well, about that time started with Jimmy in 56, okay? I had an older fellow, a friend of mine, His name was Sam Gaston. He had done banjo work, him and another guy together, the old vaudeville days. And he played the most unorthodox style, but it was pretty. He could play waltzes. He did things that I never heard anybody do. And he played at a timing that's, I wish I'd had a tape recorder and got that lot he did. It was really neat, you know. And he would do this, it was a kind of a thing like that, a waltz. And he played about everything that way. And he could play some neat stuff. He had a ball bearing, I guess it was a five, style five, plectrum banjo that he had just put a funky in it. Didn't change the neck, just drilled a hole in it, put a funky in it. Played his five string. Well, I wound up with that banjo because it was a little bit different than mine. It really had a better tone. What it was, it wasn't all that loud. It had a better tone. I swapped him, my RB250 master tone, on that old banjo, which was a ball bearing, which later I traded for a 40 hole raised head Granada. The one of them two.
Yeah, I had a ball bearing too.
No, it wasn't a ball bearing.
No, I said I had a ball bearing.
Yeah, you did, that's right. Yeah. But anyway, I had that banjo. Now, to get back to where I got the banger, they call it. In fact, Tom McKinney named that banjo, that, the banger, you know. So, anyway, I had bought a guitar, and a friend of mine's wife had stepped in it, broke it, stomped it.
Intentionally?
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, this was a Martin Herringbone. Now, I'm not sure what year it was, because back then, I never thought about it. Wasn't really interested. And I bought the guitar for $50. But all the pieces were there. And I think this could be fixed. The right guy. Well, I brought it back. I was staying with Jimmy at the time. And I told Jimmy, I said, Jimmy, I got a guitar. I just bought it. And he knew the guy that I got it from. And in fact, he's a pretty good singer. But anyway, I said, I bought this. I said, if you'll get it fixed, I'll give it to you. Well, he found some guy down in, we lived in Detroit at the time, found some fella down in Monroe, Michigan, that had a guitar repair shop, older guy, been there for years. He found out, and he said, go down with me. I said, no, I got something to do. So I didn't go. He took the guitar down, left it. And then when he come back, he says, Crowe, he says, I think I found you a badge. I said, what do you mean you think? He says, well, it was laying in a chair, had no neck in it, and it didn't have a head on it. He says, all the parts were laying in the back, he called it, which is the resonator. And it said, it covered about that much dust. You know, and I'm thinking, he said, but it had the master tone sticker in it. And I'm thinking, okay. Well, he didn't know if it was a raised head or flathead, he didn't know. He said, go pick the guitar up, go with me, we'll check it out. You know, and if we like it, you know, we'll see it. If you think it's good, we'll buy it. Okay, so all right, I went with him. And I walked in and I looked at it, you know, it was okay. And I saw what it was. But it was a no hole, had no holes in the tone. Well, that was the first one I'd ever seen like that. Well, I wasn't sure if it was real or not. So I got to looking at it, and I saw the sticker. It was authentic. It was a good shape, the shell, everything. And I looked at that tone ring, and it was, I could tell it was old. So
it wasn't a fake, it just...
No, it was just... The guy, I asked the owner about it. He said he took it in on a trade. Somebody owed him some money for a repair job. He just took the banjo for the repair job. And he said, I'd like to sell it. He said, I will get one that's got a neck and a head on it. I said, you do? So I had an RB100 that somebody made a toll ring for me as a spare. I had it in the car. I went and got it. I brought it in. I said, how would you swap? He looked at it and says, well, you want that thing, you've got to get a neck for it, put a head on it. I said, I'll do that. So I swapped that RB 100 for that banjo.
And he thought he got a good deal.
Yet he thought he got a good deal. Yeah, but I really wasn't sure. I didn't know how it was going to turn out. Just a gamble. And it worked.
So how'd you go about getting that for back in those days?
A guy named Lee Vance that lived in Cleveland, Ohio. We had played a theater there. He came to the show and we met him. He was a big fan of Jimmy and Harry. And he took us to his house and they fed us and all that stuff, you know. And he was a machinist by training. He had a neck that, well, you know the one, that had the bow tie inlay in it that had been probably a newer neck. Somebody had cut the peg head out, not like fiddle. This stuff, the fiddle peg head. And it worked. And I got that neck. He let me have that neck put in the solid ring. And he also had a set of tuners with me. He's the one who made those. And he gave me.
That you give me.
Fascinating.
I'll tell you about this banjo a little bit.
Okay.
It's similar to the banger. The guy that owned this banjo here originally was Thomas Martin. And he played with Carl and J.P. Sawson.
Oh.
And played this banjo local on W. What's the Greenville? WGRV in Green. And he pawned it to a guy. He was had habits. And he pawned it to a guy every once in a while in Greenville. And this guy that he pawned it to, he collected some stuff, instruments and stuff. But anyway, he didn't come back and get it.
Hmm.
So he lost the banjo. Alright, there's another guy in Greenville by the name of Harvey Folks. He had just graduated high school. This was in 1956, 57. And like his dad had bought him a RB-250 bow tie. Raised him. And he went over to his last name was Hensley. And this being an old banjo, the Hensley guy traded him even for the 250 bow tie. So that's the way Harvey Folks got it. Then, of course, I bought it off of Harvey Folks in 1979.
79.
Yeah.
About
this bending the third string there.
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, make
give it a little
whiner.
Yeah. So what he's saying is sometimes Earl would, instead of just rolling from one finger to the next, he would actually kind of bend up on it a little bit. Why don't you pick something? Whatever you want. Either that or something else.
Let's see. Here's one that Crowe recorded that Earl recorded. Hey, man. Nashville Blue.
Gotcha. Perfect timing.
We're ready for you.
Go right ahead.
Let me play just a touch of this, then you can play it.
Thank you. Got a lot of great tone to pull from that thing.
Sometimes you don't lose that as much as you lose the dexterity. That's what you lose. And I find out, I guess if I played a lot, I could do fairly well, but what you lose, what I do, I know where it is, but you're going to hit something and it's like you just have hit it. You don't have that solidness in that right hand that leaves. What happens when you start getting it back? Me, my hand starts getting tired. That's because I don't play. So that's what happens.
Well, can I ask you, if did that for you, did that start happening while you were still playing, or
no,
after you made the transition?
Yeah.
So as long as you were playing on the road, you
was fine. Yeah, I had no problem. You know, I was lucky. I never was bothered by arthritis or anything like that. You know, it's just that I don't play. And you lose that volume, that power, that edge. That's what that is. And you lose that a lot. And that's why you just feel like you're not as persistent on your own as you know. You know where it is, but trying to get it is hard, you know.
Well, you know, we talked a lot about the history of, you know, what JD did up until mostly through the 70s or so, but JD had a great career all the way up until just recently. You know, he won an IBMA award. Was it Lefty's Old Guitar?
Yeah.
All the students up here, and probably everybody in the room, knows about the Down Home. They played at the Down Home.
Oh, yeah.
And J.D. was one of the first acts that ever played at the Down Home when they originated. Joe Leach, Tank, they called him, was the beginning. He owned the thing. And matter of fact, I think I gave him your phone number.
That's true, you did. Yeah.
But anyway, J.D. would come in, and he would play Friday and Saturday at the Down Home. And they'd take the tables out and line the chairs up just like this. Standing room only. On Friday and Saturday night, but I guarantee it's probably way over what the fire marshal would allow. You know,
couldn't keep the people out.
But he used to pack that thing, and he'd play it not real regular, but you'd play it a couple of three times a year.
Yeah,
right. He'd pack it out every time.
My gosh. Well, we're coming down to the end. Unless there's one quick question somebody might have. Two quick questions. Let's start with Rachel, since you had your hand up.
Do you have for young folks who are trying to establish their own sound. That might not be
kind of a hard question. Well, the only thing, a lot of that develops in what you want to play. You're talking about playing the banjo?
I play fiddle personally.
You play fiddle? Just listen to all different kinds of music. And your head will, you'll figure out what kind you want to play. But it's good to listen to all kinds of different things. You know, I listen to everything. Like I said, I get on these binges. I may listen, I'll get the mood to listen to Jones. I may listen to him 2 weeks straight. That's all I listen to. Then it may be Haggard. Then it may be Flatt Scruggs. You know, then it may be Otis Redding.
Yeah.
You know, or B.B. King. And I'll listen for a week or 2 weeks of that. Nothing but that. And that all gets up here, and you start hearing little things. I mean, I do, that you pick up on that would, you can adapt over to your instrument. You know.
Didn't Earl listen to a lot of different types of music?
He did.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of those Limehouse, I mean, a lot of those tunes were jazz tunes.
A lot of big band stuff. He told me.
Nate, real quick, what you got?
All right, I just want to confirm. Is it true when you guys recorded the first album band that the studio was actually booked up and you guys recorded that in like the hallway of the studio? I heard that.
No.
That wasn't true.
In a hallway?
Yeah.
No, that wouldn't have happened.
No.
No, it was in this room. Close proximity, but it was in the room, you know. That's a great, right there is one of my favorite all-time recording sessions. It's that whole deal. Yeah, but we had a ball doing those. You know, to me it was easy. Because that happened, Doyle had worked with me 5 years, totally worked with me 5 years. We all knew each other. Bobby Hicks, we grew up listening to him. You know, we all had that same touch right up here. We heard it. You know, and he put Todd Phillips on the bass. I mean, he's a master of the bass. And he picked up on the timing, that groove, you know. And it just like, hey, this is great, you know. We played things that we wanted to play the way we heard them. You know, pay tribute to all the different pickers. You know, the Osmonds, Monroe, Flatt Scruggs, Jim, Jesse, you know. We did them the way we heard them.
To close things out, would it be a stretch to ask you to do that break from Blue Ridge Cabin home?
Oh,
you
Lord.
Think you got that in you, or that pinch and the... Everybody all over the world does this, just like you.
You know where I got that? Take a guess.
Earl Scruggs.
Exactly. You know, I mean, that's where I got it. He did it. And I don't know, what's the big deal? It's just, I just did what he did. And I think he did it better.
Well, some reason nobody remembered it the way they remembered
well,
yours.
Because he didn't do it a lot. You know, you didn't hear him play that song. I don't think they ever hardly, after a certain period, they never did that song again.
Yeah.
You know, after about a year or two after they recorded that on their TV show, they did it mostly there. I never really heard them do it a lot live. But on the TV show, they did. But that not out in concert, I never really... He didn't do a lot of that stuff again. And if he did it different.
Yeah, that's the
thing.
We hear recordings as like a snapshot, but I'm sure you must. Did you play it every time that way? Every time?
That's because it's kind of a recognizable thing. You know what it's going to be.
Okay.
So you hear that.
Everybody knows where the downbeat's
going to be. But I was fooling the guys on the stage. The last year or two, while retired, we do a home place. Well, I do that pinch. And every time it would throw my guitar player, he had that in his mind that I did that only on Blue Ridge. You can do it on a home place. Same thing. But you go into a home place.
Okay.
you know, and it was funny, and I knew it just to aggravate him.
Because you know? He'd start the other song.
Oh, right? Yeah, yeah. You know, and he'd look at me, and I thought, I got you. You know, I like new stuff like that. But it worked, you know.
We listen to those records so much.
Yeah.
We expect them to be a certain
way. You can do a lot of those like that. I used to do that, just to aggravate them.
Do you have anything else, JD, that you wanted to talk about with all these folks today?
Let's see. No, I had something. I don't know. I forgot what it was. See, it happens. Too much banjo. No, I'd really like to thank Jerry. I've been friends for years. He's like a brother. But Susie's wife, her great pickers too. We're fortunate to have him.
Oh yeah. We are very fortunate to have him.
And this program here, I've heard about it for years. You know, and it's a great program.
Thank you.
Well,
I appreciate all of our visitors coming today too. When people heard you were going to be here.
See all these my picking buddies back here, Jimmy Millsaps, Little Rose, and all the rest of you know who you are.
Well, thank you so much, JD, for coming out today. And again, thank you all the students who are in the seminar classes, all the students here. Some of them are majors, some of them are minors. Right. A lot of them are playing music. And to get to meet one of our banjo heroes, it's just a treat today. Thank you, JD. Appreciate it all. And Jerry Keith. Thank you.
Mountain.